Good morning, everyone. Thank you, praise team. It's good to see everyone here this morning. I know that we're all familiar with the phrase opposites attract. We see it all the time in married couples. One is an extrovert and a little bit loud, and the other is quiet and shy. One enjoys going out while the other prefers to relax at home. One says potato, and the other one says mashed potatoes. You understand what I'm saying. Some people may wonder why opposites do attract, and perhaps the simple reason is that each person offers something that the other lacks, making the relationship feel a little bit more complete. Today, as we continue with our short series about the Apostle Peter, we're going to look at a passage that contains Peter and the Apostle John, who, in their own right, were opposites. So let's pray first. Our God in heaven, as we read your scriptures and hear your words of your message, we ask that you open our eyes and touch our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Peter and John were partners in ministry, and they're often found together in Scripture. Luke chapter 5 tells us that they were partners in the fishing business. Jesus had sent both of them to prepare what would be his last Passover. They were the first two disciples at the open tomb and at the resurrection. And together they ministered to the Samaritans who accepted the word of God. And now that they were filled with the Holy Spirit, the apostles were no longer competing for greatness with one another, but were at last working faithfully together to build the church. Psalm 133 says, "How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity." However, Peter and John were a bit different from one another. Peter was outgoing and sociable. He always had something to say, and he never hesitated to give his opinion. He was the type who refused to look before he leaped. He was quite outspoken, and he was the first disciple to confess that Jesus was the Son of God. Tanya had mentioned this last week. And Peter also had a bit of a temper that was displayed by cutting off the ear of the high priest's slave when Jesus was arrested. Tanya also mentioned this last week. The Bible presents Peter as compassionate, loyal to Jesus, but he also showed doubt, even denying Jesus three times. John, on the other hand, was contemplative and reflective. He was tender and sympathetic. He was referred to as the disciple whom Jesus loved. At the Last Supper, he was the one leaning on Jesus' chest. And John was the only disciple who was at the crucifixion. But John also had an aggressive side. In Luke chapter 9, Jesus was not being welcomed into a Samaritan village. John and his brother James asked Jesus if they should call fire down from heaven to destroy the village. And Jesus rebuked them. That's why Jesus gave them the nickname, the Sons of Thunder. Despite the character differences that John and Peter had, God put them together as his ambassadors of the gospel. So let's read from Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer. It was 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth, some translations say a man who was crippled from birth, was being carried to the temple, and the gate was called Beautiful. He was put there every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. And when he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." How many times have you said to someone, "Look at me," when you want their attention? I do that with my granddaughter. If we're talking about something and I want her to know I'm serious, I say, Reese, look at me. And she just stops and she looks. And she understands that I need her attention. Peter said, look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. The lame beggar, whose name we will never know, was placed at the gate called Beautiful each day. He was at that gate for a reason. It was the main gate used to enter Jerusalem, and it provided the easiest and most direct access to the temple. It was the gate that was used by the more influential and affluent members of society and provided the beggar with the best opportunity to receive the alms that he was seeking. Since Peter and John were going to the temple to pray, it made sense for them to enter through this gate because it gave easy access for them to the temple. And we know that the disciples were men of simple means who lived on the generosity of those they visited. And on this day, the beggar would receive something much better than silver or gold. He would receive the use of his legs, which he never used before in his entire life. When Peter performed the gift of healing by calling on the name of Jesus, the man was completely healed. And Peter nor John asked the man to be silent about what happened. As a matter of fact, they walked with him into the temple courts for everyone to see the miracle. That's the total opposite of what Jesus did when he healed some people. In Mark chapter 1, verses 41 through 45, we're told that a man with leprosy came to see Jesus and begged him on his knees. He said, if you're willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and he touched the man. He said, I am willing. Be clean. Immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. Jesus sent him away at once with a strong warning. See that you don't tell this to anyone. But go and show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded of your cleansing as a testimony to them. Instead, he went out and he began to talk freely, spreading the news. As a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places. Yet people still came to him from everywhere. And also in the book of Mark, chapter 7, verses 31 through 37, we read that Jesus left the vicinity of Tyre and went through Sidon down to the Sea of Galilee and into the region of Decapolis. There some people brought to him a man who was deaf, who could hardly talk, and they begged Jesus to place his hand on him. After he took him aside away from the crowd, Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears. He then spit on and touched the man's tongue. He looked to heaven, and with a deep sigh, he said to him, Ephphatha, which means be opened. At this, the man's ears were opened, his tongue was loosened, and he began to speak plainly. Jesus commanded them to not tell anyone. But the more he did so, the more they kept talking about it. People were overwhelmed with amazement. He had done everything well, they said. He even makes the deaf hear and the mute speak. The reason why Jesus commanded people not to speak of the miracles he performed was because he didn't want the people's focus to be on healing and on miracles. He wanted their focus to be on the gospel message that he was sharing. But neither man was silent about the healing, and that put a huge target on the back of Jesus. Peter and John had no need for the lame beggar to be silent about his healing because, well, Jesus had already risen from the dead, and many people believed that. Healing people was part of the ministry that Jesus called them to do, and it was important for the disciples to show the people that the Holy Spirit was now within them to help them continue the ministry of Jesus Christ. Matthew 10, verse 1 says that Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and every sickness. But like Jesus, their healing ministry also put a large target on their backs because there were still many powerful people who did not believe in the resurrection. And that put the disciples and many of the Jesus followers in danger. The Sadducees believed that there was no resurrection and that there was neither angels nor spirits. The Sadducees were the party of high priests, aristocratic families, and merchants, the wealthier elements of the population. They were the political elite, heavily involved in political affairs, including collaborating with the Romans. You know, it's not unusual for God's people to have targets on their backs and to be persecuted for their beliefs. In the book of Daniel, we're told that a proclamation was issued that upon hearing the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music, everyone must fall down and worship the images of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. And anyone who does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow down and worship the idol whenever they heard the music, as everyone else was doing. They were thrown into the blazing furnace, but were protected by an angel of the Lord. They were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. And in the book of Esther, we learned about a man named Mordecai who was Queen Esther's cousin. King Xerxes had issued a command that everyone must bow down to show respect to his son Haman whenever he passed by. And Mordecai refused to bow down. The only one that Mordecai would bow down to is the God of heaven and the God of earth. This outraged Haman, and he set out to destroy Mordecai and every Jew in the Persian Empire. But in the end, Haman was the one who perished by the same means that he intended to kill Mordecai. It was Queen Esther who interceded on Mordecai's behalf with the king, but it was God who opened King Xerxes' heart. There are times in every life when to do what is right, we simply cannot hide in a crowd. We may have to stand alone. Have you ever been persecuted in any way for your belief in Jesus Christ? Was there ever a time when it was necessary for you to stand alone in a crowd for your beliefs? New Life is standing alone for its beliefs by seeking to exit the RCA. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Please remember that God always honors those who honor him. God said in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 30, "I will honor those who honor me, and I will despise those who think lightly of me." As you read and study these first 10 verses of chapter 3, you'll come to realize that there were actually two healings that were performed. The first was a physical healing. The man had been lame for 40 years. We're told that in Acts chapter 4. And he had to be carried to and from the beautiful gate each day. Peter invoked the name of Jesus Christ, reached out his hand, and helped the man to walk. Think about how miraculous that was. He never used his legs before, so he had absolutely no muscle power or strength. And now he was strong and walking. In this day and age, a person would need months and months and months of physical therapy. Matt can attest to that. All this man needed was the power of Jesus. The second healing was a spiritual healing. Not only was the man walking for the first time, but he was also praising God, probably for the first time. And he was doing it for what had happened. He was literally jumping for joy over what God had done for him. We don't know much about the man except that every day for 40 years he needed people to carry him to the gate so that he could beg for money and then carry him home. That was the life that he knew. And the only purpose that he had in life was to survive another day to beg. That is, until he met Jesus. The man was begging for money every day for 40 years just to survive, but on that particular day, he got more than money. He received eternal life. The man's life was transformed, and his soul was transformed. I think that each of us should be able to associate with the lame beggar, because this passage about Peter and John healing a crippled man also serves as a metaphor for our healing. Weren't we all spiritually crippled before we met Jesus? It wasn't John or Peter who gave us a hand to get up and to heal us. It was Jesus. Jesus extended his hand to us and said, "Get up and walk. Get up and walk with me." And we've been walking together with him ever since. The miracle that was performed here addressed the root of the man's problem. He needed to walk. There are many symptoms of sin that make us miserable, such as vanity, lust, covetousness, bitterness, hate, selfishness, and the list goes on and on. The Lord Jesus addresses the root of our problem. We need atonement for our sin. He takes away the guilt, making us right with God. He works a miracle on our behalf. Christ says to us, "Rise and walk," meaning walk with him. When we know we're forgiven, there is still sin in us, but the power of sin is now broken. We now want to honor the Lord, put to death sin, and be thankful followers. We are grieved by sin, but now we have an advocate who forgives and loves us. Imagine what it is not to have Christ as Savior. Without Christ, we are on our own before God. There is inevitable death. There is the power of the devil that encompasses us. There is a load of guilt that we cannot pay. Our steps lead inevitably to destruction, and justly so. It's completely opposite for those who have Christ. God loves the work of Christ and the work of his Spirit. He sees it in us. He is a father who, though seeing weakness in his children, sees also their heart, which he loves, and acts to have Christ formed in us. Everyone in Christ is a new creature, and the Father loves them with all the same love that he has for his own Son. The Lord always does more than we can think or imagine. The crippled man only sought enough money to probably buy supper for the night. Christ stood him on his feet, put his hand in the hand of the apostle, signifying he will be one of his people. And it would have been strange if this man had not praised God. But he does, and he does it jubilantly. Rise and walk are blessed words. So is the heart that calls on the Lord. Oftentimes, we associate the word miracle with what I'll call major league events. Someone being healed after receiving a potentially life-ending diagnosis. A mom giving birth after she was told she would never have children. Someone walking away from an unscathed total car wreck. Or a body that's been healed after a lifetime of addiction. Those are indeed big-ticket miracles, and we should never stop praying that God would continue to be generous with miracles like that, according to His will. But let us never forget the everyday miracles that occur all around us. We breathe in this stuff called air, and we need it to live. The sanctuary is full of it, so is every room in your house. It's in the car you drive, and somehow it follows you everywhere you go. Breathing is actually two miracles. The first is the act of inhaling and exhaling because it's governed by our brains that choreograph that function. And the second miracle is that we can't see, touch, or smell the stuff that we breathe in to live. And what's equally amazing is that most times, we don't even realize that we're breathing in and out. It happens when we're awake and when we're asleep. On average, we breathe in and breathe out 22,000 times a day. All of that is a miracle. And what about the body itself? God created it out of an act of love, and it grows to contain a total of 78 different organs. If you get cut, the body heals itself. If you cut your nails, they grow back. If you cut your hair, the body grows it back. Well, that's not a really good example. Your body knows how much liquid to keep and how much solid food to keep before it helps you to get rid of it. Folks, we're talking about miracles that God created, little miracles that we do every day, that we should never forget. The passage that we looked at puts Peter and John together in ministry, but it was Peter in the leadership role. But there was someone greater than Peter who made everything happen, and that was the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, there would not have been a healing, there would not have been a miracle. Peter and John would have probably still preached the gospel, as all the other apostles would have, but without the Holy Spirit, there could not have been complete acceptance by any believer. Peter and John were just the vessels used by the Holy Spirit to heal this man. This series is about the Apostle Peter, and today's passage features Peter and John. But in actuality, today is about the Holy Spirit. This passage is about the work of the Holy Spirit and should give us all assurances that the gifts of the Spirit are still active for this modern-day church. In chapter 12 of his first letter to the Corinthians, Paul identifies those gifts. To one is given a message of wisdom through the Spirit, to another a message of knowledge by that same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the performing of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. The Holy Spirit is just like the air that we breathe. We can't see the air, and we can't see the Holy Spirit. But both are there when we need them. And just like the air is here with us in this sanctuary, the Holy Spirit is here right now as well. And He's ready to transform you over and over and over again. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You for all that we heard today in the scripture that we read. We thank you for your apostles, Lord, who walked the earth to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we know that your Holy Spirit is alive and well and puts his hands on us when we need it, Lord. And Father, today, I know that there are people here who are in pain, whether it's physical pain, whether it's emotional pain, whether it's spiritual pain. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I ask, Lord, that you put your hands upon them and heal them. Help them rise and walk with you, Lord, in a stronger way than they're walking with you right now. Help us all to rise and walk in a stronger way that we're walking with you right now, Lord. We thank you for your apostles. We thank you for your son, Jesus. And we pray this all in his name. Amen.